motion. This is applied mainly in pipe networks, distribution in pipe networks. Distribution of water in pipe networks is a network of pipe. This is A. This is B, depending on your area of coverage. So, this is from our basic plan to know, so that A, Q is equal to AB, that is the area of the cross section of flow multiplied by the velocity. So the sum of the discharge at A, discharge at B, and discharge at C, which we can say QT is equal to UA plus UB plus QC plus QN. We have N. And remember, sorry, before we talk of this, we also, this energy that is lost, you can encounter a situation, you have not done what you're supposed to do, but energy has been lost. Then you can also add energy, increase energy, by the use of pumps. Talked about. And you can also abstract energy by the use of turbine from the water flow. And if the turbine you connect to electrical and it's electrical core and so on, you generate electric field and from there generate some current and electricity. And you can pause it here so that we can come. In an open channel flow, three flows or three types of flows are encountered depending on some of the conditions you need in the field. First, you can have normal flow. You can have flow that is higher than this or below this. So, in fact, you can represent it in this way. Normal flow, and when that normal flow is exceeded, it becomes, when anything higher than that critical point becomes supercritical. And if I have another below it, you have subcritical. And when flow is not checked, if that is not controlled, it's the generator of the problem. Or it can be the minimum your channel can tolerate or the flow you can make use of. When it goes higher than that, it becomes supercritical and there is danger. When it goes below it, it becomes subcritical and there will be also danger. For instance, when you have supercritical, your channels are in danger of suffering erosion. Probably you have designed your channel, you have made every calculation of the flow you will put on the velocity and so on. But if that velocity is running at the desired, you may not have problem. When there is a sudden change higher than the critical position you have, area where Direct critical results. and it is shall be to handle it very well. Otherwise, the end will be defeated. The end of their clothing. When you are carrying an irrigation water, there is a specific amount of water you would like to reach your field for irrigation. Some of them may be lost in the field as a result of the critical condition. And if the channel is not lined, assuming it's a channel, you may encounter some problems because of the critical conditions. Okay. We rest that then.
That's a story. So
average their outflow. Okay? You subtract the average of the outflow from the average of the inflow. It means also that the storage, this is the initial storage, and this is the final storage, or the second storage. That there is variation. If you have variation here and here, there will also be variation in the storage. Yes. And if it is a reservoir, then probably a reservoir you are storing your water for irrigation. You know your consumptive use. You know the quantity of water you need. And such is a quarry, then you should take precautions. And this variation in storage will be as a result of many things. It's analogous to the losses you are talking about. Okay? Many things can cause change in the storage. That's losses. Those losses can be as a result of evaporation from the surface of the water. That could also be as a result of seepage or deep percolation. Evaporation, seepage, deep percolation. Seepage goes naturally, or deep percolation goes now. Could be as a result of if there are no checks. If there are no checks on human beings and animals, water abstraction, going there to fetch water, carrying water and water, can result in the flow, in the storage being low or being less. Animals can go there and drink and water. Human beings can go there and carry water and fetch water and go. So that brings about the variation in storage. But then it depends on the surface water. So what we are saying is that if you are getting your reservoir after constructing, you put an equipment you will use to gauge and later on, so at any point in time, you gauge to know the losses. You know how the losses are occurring, and that should give you a concern. So when you are doing this, you are talking of the flow routing. Because you are controlling, you want to know the control, the movement of the flow inside that reservoir, whether it will be enough for you or not for you to do what you want to do. So when we are doing routing, there are factors or sometimes we consider inflow hydrograph, we consider outflow, or spillway discharge. You know, spillway is a safety device. When your storage is going beyond your estimated volume, estimated when the storage is going, when the outflow, inflow is increasing, the spillway comes into rescue. It's a safety device so that it can let off some of the volume of water. Because if that is not done, maybe it's in a dam, it will cause problems. Overtopping. And if there is overtopping, the dam could be washed away. the volume of water that is coming for some time, most of whom you have like this. So give you a peak. That shows you when you have a peak inflow or a peak outflow. Portion.
So the flow capacity of the spillway, the flow capacity should also be noted. And one of the models, one of the equations to calculate that is Q is equal to 1C is the wear coefficient, the coefficient of the wear, where the water environment, and H is the depth of flow over the wear, depth of flow. Remember, we talked about the normal, the quality wear, or quality notch, you know, or where you have the contracted, the double contracted, and the normal wear. So, but in planning your irrigation, because you are storing the water for irrigation in the reservoir, which you are doing the flood routing, you must know the peak flow. You must know your peak flow. Or, I mean, the flood is whether you will be able to store enough water that will help you during the irrigation season. And also, depending on the type of crop in question. You know, some you may be involved in aquatic crop like rice. And in that case, you need to irrigate with a very large quantity of water. And also the maturity period, the duration. It will be another crop that you can plant and can mature in 2 months or 3 months or whatever. In that case, you irrigate and after that time it stops. But nevertheless, you must have the quantity of water that will be enough for you in the irrigation. Maybe you are doing complete irrigation. That is every other water that is needed by the plant or by the crop is supplied through irrigation. That's full irrigation, complete irrigation. Or it may be a partial irrigation or supplemental irrigation. Well, the rainfall provides some of the water. The rainfall provides some of the water. Then we use the irrigation to supplement what is lacking, what is left. Which the rainfall, supplies of. So, and to know this, look at the flood stages, as we talked about, to guide you to know the peak flow. So one of the ways to determine the peak flow is to note the flood marks. The flood marks, or what we call historical indications. The physical historical indications. That directs you the levels the water have passed. And their time as a flood marks. Or another way could be by the use of empirical formula, which will help you to know what determines the peak flow. That's a guide. And another could be envelope curve. By the use of envelope curve, that's grouping together all areas with the similar topography and climatic conditions. What happens there? You will group them together and envelope. You will group them together and look at the concentrations, look at the peak periods, and determine what you want. You can also use the rational formula. Well, you see that Q is equal to CIA. And use it to determine the peak, the rational method. There are other aspects, other ways you can do flood studies. clock frequencies for this or the unit hydrograph. That will help you to get what you want. And the essence of determining this peak flow, is to guide you in your planning. The peak flow occurs during this time and this time. And if it is a peak flow, if I am starting my irrigation by that time, I am sure the quantity or the volume of water I will have in my reservoir will be able to guide me. But if you are starting outside the peak flow, this is a peak flow here. Probably you did this plotting based on the months of the year. This is June, for instance. That's when you have your peak flow. And you want to start your irrigation to August for a crop that may last 3 months, 4 months, 5 months. You know that at this peak flow, you will have enough water. But what will happen between here and here? A month has been elapsed. And if this crop, the last plant from here to, let's say, December or November, then what you have to ask yourself or worry about is that the peak flow is here, and after that, the flow will recede. Then, and I am starting my irrigation when the flow is receding. Now, and it will last for about 4 months or 5 months or whatever. The flood I will have, or the quantity of storage I will have, will it be able to go through this irrigation season? Will it be able to lead me, to see me through, to carry me along throughout the irrigation season? If not, you can make adjustments in your planning, assuming you are